Thank you, Erling. After decades of intense research and development, a mysterious new technology emerges. Idealists prepare for a vision of liberation and revolution, while established players first ignore it, then ridicule and shame it. On the other hand, technologists and nerds see an enormous potential and spend their nights and weekends tinkering with it. Eventually, products, companies, and entire industries emerge to commercialize it and bring it to the mainstream. It makes the world more connected, more productive, and using it becomes part of school for anyone, even in first grade. Later, many people wonder why the powerful promise of this technology wasn't more obvious from the start. So which technology am I talking about? The personal computer in the 70s, the internet in the 90s, and I think Bitcoin today. So today I'm going to tell you what Bitcoin is and how it will change money, payments, and finance. But first, let's meet a few other people that also see a big potential in Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a technological tour de force. It is better than currency, said Bill Gates. Bitcoin offers a sweeping vista of opportunity to reimagine how the financial system can and should work in the internet era. Marc Andreessen, co-founder of Netscape. I am a big fan of Bitcoin, said Al Gore. And Bitcoin is a remarkable achievement and the ability to create something that is not duplicable in the digital world has enormous value. Eric Schmidt, chairman of Google. So what is Bitcoin? What are these guys talking about? Since 1980, computer scientists have been researching how to get thousands of computers in a network to all agree on the state of a system, to reach consensus, even if some of those computers were lying because their owners had bad intentions or because they were infected by a virus. But it wasn't until 30 years later, when Bitcoin came in 2009, that a practical solution was found. Bitcoin's solution to the problem, Bitcoin's technological breakthrough, is the concept of the blockchain. The blockchain is a public journal of every Bitcoin transaction that has ever occurred since the beginning of Bitcoin in 2009. Every few minutes, tens of thousands of independent Bitcoin servers all over the world agree to update the journal. They all agree to add another page, another block of transactions to the public journal. And because Bitcoin is open source, anyone can put up their own Bitcoin server to verify transactions. If someone tries to break the system, for instance, by creating counterfeit Bitcoins, they will simply be rejected by the rest of the network because they can see in the public journal that these new units do not have a legitimate history. So for the first time ever, thousands and millions of people all over the world can send pieces of digital property to each other in a way that is guaranteed to be safe and secure, and that everyone can verify is correct. And all this without relying on centralized institutions or middlemen, but simply using math and peer-to-peer communication in an open system. This is the technological breakthrough of Bitcoin. This is what makes Bitcoins valuable and useful, because nothing like it has ever existed before. So let's look at some of the problems that Bitcoin solves. According to Goldman Sachs, every year card payment transaction fees amount to 125 billion euros every year. And according to a study from LexisNexis, merchants lose 80 billion euros every year in payment card fraud. Those are huge numbers. And the reason we have these problems is that payment cards were designed for use in physical stores where the merchant met the customer face to face. But today, in most transactions, the merchant doesn't know the customer personally, but sensitive payment account information is sent across the world through wires and is then stored on vulnerable servers for years that can be hacked. Payment cards were invented in the 1950s. Imagine if you drove a car from 1950. It wouldn't go very fast, and it wouldn't be very fuel efficient. And it would have neither airbags, neck rests, or even seat belts. It wouldn't be a very safe car. Yet today, we still use technology from 1950 to protect our money and payments. Even recent innovations in mobile payments still built on top of the old payment card infrastructure, which was never designed for the internet. But one application of Bitcoin is money for the internet. And in fact, many merchants have discovered this already. For instance, Hungary, where you can order takeaway food from 800 restaurants and pay with Bitcoin. And Wikipedia, where you can donate in Bitcoin. And you can pay for your computers from Dell in Bitcoin. And there are many, many other merchants. So what are some of the advantages that these merchants have seen in Bitcoin payments? Bitcoin payments cost less. Accepting payment cards online typically has a fee of 3% per transaction. Then an average merchant will lose 2% more in fraud, for a total of 5%. Bitcoin transactions cost just 2 euro cents, regardless of whether you're receiving 10 euros or 10 million euros. Regular payment systems block dozens of markets, as can be seen on this map. Bitcoin knows no borders. As a merchant, when you accept Bitcoin payments, you can receive from any of the 200 countries in the world. Bitcoin payments are easier. When you pay online with a card, you have to leave your computer, find your wallet, find your card, then you enter 23 digits from your card, then you double check you entered those correctly. And if you're shopping internationally, you have to enter an additional 3D secure password. That's an 8-step process to pay, which can lose a lot of customers. Paying with Bitcoin is just 2 steps. You click a button on the website, you enter your password, and you're done. So that was Bitcoin in payments. But Bitcoin is also a very efficient vehicle for sending money to friends and family in developing countries. And the importance of these so-called money remittances is hard to overstate. More than 3 times as much money is sent to developing countries as person-to-person transfers than as national foreign aid. So meet Ronald from Kampala in Uganda. To pay for his education, Ronald receives money from his sister, who lives in the US. Using traditional payment channels, they would pay an average of 9% in transfer fees. Using Bitcoin, again, they would pay just 2 euro cents, regardless of the amount. And Ronald doesn't even need a computer to do this. He can use just any simple phone that can send and receive SMS. And because there are people in Uganda who want to buy Bitcoin, Ronald can sell his Bitcoins to them and receive local currency at little to no cost. Putting payments and money transfers together, Goldman Sachs estimates that Bitcoin can save the world 160 billion euros every year in transaction fees. And then imagine the opportunity when everyone with a simple phone can transact with anyone else in the world. According to the World Bank, 50% of the global adult population do not have bank accounts. I'll repeat that. Half of the adult population of the world do not have bank accounts. That's billions of people who can't do electronic transfers. They have no access to loans or credit. And anyone with a knife can steal their cash savings. With Bitcoin, for the first time ever, these people can get an electronic money account. They can do electronic transfers. They can store their savings safely, encrypted. And they can even get access to loans and credit from abroad. Bitcoin will change their lives. And the economic progress we will see when half of the adult population of the world joins the global economy will probably change everything else too. So that was Bitcoin in payments and transfers, but it can do more. This is Renato, who lives in Sao Paulo in Brazil. Renato has an idea for a coffee trading website, but he needs $2,000 to build it, and he decides to crowdfund. Using a traditional crowdfunding service such as Kickstarter, Renato would pay 8% in processing fees. In return, he would get a trusted platform that promises to pay back investors if his project isn't fully funded. But Bitcoin can do this too. So now enter self-enforcing Bitcoin blockchain contracts, which are contracts you can program to exercise a certain behavior given certain conditions. These contracts are unbreakable because the software executes them, even without a court system. So for instance, Renato can create a contract with an account that investors can fund. If it's fully funded, the contract will pay out the money directly to Renato. If it's not funded, within, say, 30 days, the contract will automatically return the money to the investors. And the beautiful thing about this is that the investors do not need to trust Renato. They don't even need to trust a third-party service, because they can read in the contract on the Bitcoin blockchain that this is what will happen. This is what the code will do. But let's assume Renato actually gets funded. Now the contract can even issue shares in his company. How would that work? So the contract would take tiny units of a Bitcoin worth less than 1 euro cent, and then give those units an electronic stamp. Now Renato can publicly declare that each of these units represent one share in his company. And the contract can then distribute the shares to investors to their Bitcoin wallets in proportion to how much they invested. When the company gets profitable, the contract can even pay out dividends directly to the shareholders at that point in time. So for the first time ever, people can raise capital and maintain shareholder registries without using fallible middlemen, centralized institutions, but using a completely open and completely transparent Bitcoin system. But contracts can do even more. Let's say Renato has a lot of coffee in stock and he wants to protect himself from the coffee price fluctuations. So he decides to enter into a CFD, a contract for difference, with another party, such as Tina. Tina wants to invest in coffee as a commodity. So now both Tina and Hinato pay in one Bitcoin to the contract, which now holds two Bitcoins in total. The contract can last for a period of, say, 30 days. If at the end of that contract, the coffee price goes down by 50%, then the contract can automatically pay out both Bitcoins to Hinato. So now Hinato lost value in his coffee stock, but he gained value in his Bitcoin wallet. On the other hand, if the coffee price goes up by 100%, the contract could pay out half a Bitcoin to Hinato and 1.5 Bitcoin to Tina. So now Tina made a profit on her coffee investment. And it's not just coffee that these contracts can track. Any asset imaginable you can track the price of can be used in contracts. Gold, dollars, euros, stocks, other securities, and so on. So for instance, why invest in physical gold that you need to store in your own home that can get stolen, if instead you can buy a Bitcoin gold contract that you can store on your hard drive encrypted or in Dropbox? Just like the physical gold, this gold contract has no counterparty risk because the contract is self-enforced on the blockchain. So now you know that Bitcoin is money. But you also know that Bitcoin is so much more. Saying Bitcoin is just money is like saying the internet is just a fancy telephone. Bitcoin is a technology. And once technologies are invented, they tend to last a very long time. They cannot be uninvented. And today I've talked about just a few of the possibilities of Bitcoin. There are many others, such as decentralized voting systems, decentralized data storage in the cloud. And in the earlier session, the speakers talked about the Internet of Things. So far, things haven't been able to get bank accounts. To get a bank account, you have needed either a physical person or a corporation. With Bitcoin, for the first time, things can get bank accounts. So maybe these self-driving cars don't even need Uber. Maybe these self-driving cars could be truly autonomous with their own money accounts, so they get paid by customers, they can go to the mechanic on their own and pay him, they could pay for their own insurance. Why need Uber? In the past decades, we have seen limited innovation in finance. And the reason is that banks ensure the security of their systems, for good and for bad, by limiting access. So to launch a financial service, you have had to ask your competitors for permission. Bitcoin is different. Bitcoin is actually the opposite. Because being open source, Bitcoin is a completely open garden for anyone to use and extend. In Bitcoin, any entrepreneur has the same capabilities as the biggest banks of today have in the banking industry. On the web, you don't need to ask for permission to publish your website. And that has created limitless innovation in media and communication. In Bitcoin, you don't need to ask for permission from your competitors to launch your financial service. You just write the code, publish it, and now you reach millions of customers. And this simple fact will also create limitless innovation in finance. And I can't wait to see what people will create. My final words will be the two questions that are really left. Which applications do we build on top of Bitcoin technology? And who among you will be the digital winners that will bring this technology to consumers? Thank you.
Thank you, Lasse. I think I have time for one question. It's undeniable that Bitcoin has been regarded as sort of a speculative affair because of the value fluctuations that I mentioned initially. I mean, if you get a currency and you don't know whether it's worth $100 or $1,000, it's really hard to treat it as a method of payment. I know there are ways to manage that because you can immediately change into dollars or other currencies. But in your view, what is the most important thing to happen with Bitcoin for it to become a more accepted method of payment?
I think it's a usability question. So when the internet started getting traction in the beginning of the 90s, it was really only professors in universities that thought it was fun to send an email to each other. No one had really created the apps of internet, like Facebook or YouTube, that made it useful for even my grandmother. And I think that's the apps we will need to see created in Bitcoin as well, and generally just making it easier to use.
Thank you very much. Thank you again to Lasse.